Death, an inevitable event that often comes unexpectedly, raises difficult questions for the human heart. But when death reaches the youngest, those questions become even more distressing. What happens to children when they die? Do they go straight to heaven? Is there a possibility that hell is your destiny? Do children have the ability to decide about their eternity? How does God's grace influence your eternal destiny? What does the Bible teach about your eternal destiny? These concerns have been the focus of countless theological conversations and debates throughout the centuries. They are profound questions that deserve to be answered with sensitivity and based on the Word of God. In this video, we'll dive into Scripture to take a closer look at what the Bible says about the fate of children who die. We will explore how God, in His justice and mercy, treats these innocent souls, and we will address the most relevant interpretations and perspectives within the Christian tradition. Before we begin, we would like to know your perspective on this topic and how it has impacted your life. We invite you to leave us your comments. We will be happy to read them and know your opinion. Let's get started. What happens to children after their death? This is, without a doubt, one of the most profound and sensitive questions that, as a parent, has troubled me over the years. There is nothing that worries me more than the eternal destiny of my children. Knowing whether they will be safe in the arms of God, whether they will be saved, is one of the greatest concerns I carry in my heart. And I am not alone in this. Many parents around the world share this same concern, because the love we feel for our children leads us to reflect on their well-being, not only here on earth, but also in eternity. That is why I have decided to approach this topic with the greatest care and depth possible. My intention is not only to find answers for my own peace, but also to offer encouragement and comfort to other parents who, like me, care deeply about the spiritual safety of their little ones. Now, when the issue of the destiny of children after death is addressed, several theological positions arise based on the interpretation of the Scriptures, Christian tradition, and the nature of God. These perspectives seek to answer a deeply emotional and spiritual question: what happens to the souls of the little ones? Next, we will explore the main theological positions on this topic. First of all, the doctrine of innocence. This position holds that children who die before reaching the age of moral responsibility, the age at which an individual is considered able to discern between right and wrong, are automatically saved and do not go to hell. The reason behind this belief is that children do not have the capacity to commit conscious sin, so they are not accountable for their actions before God. Proponents of this position believe that God, in His infinite mercy and justice, saves children in a special way. One of the passages that is frequently cited is 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 23, where King David expresses that although his deceased son will not return, he himself will go to him in the afterlife. Let us note what the biblical account says. But what reason do I have to fast now that he is dead? Can I bring him back to life? One day I will go to him, but he cannot return to me. This is interpreted as a sign of hope that children who die are with God in a place of salvation, not in hell. In second place, divine election and the covenant of grace. Reformed or Calvinist perspective. From a Calvinist or Reformed perspective, the fate of children who die is believed to be dependent on God's sovereign election. According to this doctrine, although all human beings are born with a fallen and sinful nature, the salvation of children who die is an act of God's sovereign grace. This group believes that God, in His wisdom and mercy, chooses to save children according to His covenant of grace, without their having to exercise faith or make conscious decisions about sin. In this approach, children are not believed to go to hell, as God's grace covers those who do not have the ability to decide for themselves. This view emphasizes God's sovereignty to save those He has chosen, regardless of whether they have reached moral maturity or not. In third place, the effectiveness of Christ's work. Another position holds that Christ's death on the cross has a universal scope, including those who die without having the capacity to accept or reject the gospel, such as little children. According to this view, Christ's sacrifice covers the sin of those who are not morally responsible, such as children who die before reaching spiritual maturity. In this case, Jesus' sacrifice is seen as effective in covering the sin of all mankind without exception, and therefore children who die do not go to hell, but are covered by God's grace through Christ's work on the cross. Passages such as John chapter 1 verse 29, "Behold, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world." They are interpreted as an indication that Christ's work is universal in scope and sufficient to save everyone, even those who cannot make conscious decisions about sin. In fourth place, the Arminian position. Arminians, in contrast to the Calvinist view, believe in the freedom of human will to choose or reject God. However, in relation to children, some Arminians believe that God, in His justice and mercy, does not condemn children who die before reaching the age of moral responsibility. In this case, there is trust that God, being just and knowing the capacity of each child, extends His grace to those who do not have the opportunity to make a conscious choice. Although this position does not have a single consensus, many Arminians hold that children who die are received by God in His mercy, since they have not had the opportunity to reject His grace, and therefore are not condemned to hell. In fifth place, the universal sinfulness position. Some Christians hold that all human beings, even children, are born with a sinful nature due to the fall of Adam and Eve, and all of them, without exception, need the salvation of Christ. In this context, it is believed that although young children do not have the capacity to exercise conscious faith, their original sin is covered by the work of Christ, and they are not condemned to hell. Some interpret that because original sin is a factor inherent to all, even to children, the salvation that Christ offers is universally accessible, and deceased children are covered by the grace of God, not by their own faith, but by the grace that God gives. Finally, the justice and mercy of God, a more open position, shared by many evangelical traditions, emphasizes that the fate of children is entirely under the sovereignty, justice, and love of God. God, being perfect in His judgments, is trusted to act according to His merciful nature. This perspective is often based on passages such as Matthew chapter 19 verse 14, where Jesus says, "Suffer little children to come to me, and do not forbid them, for of such belongs the kingdom of heaven." Now, after having analyzed various theological perspectives on this topic, it is essential to fully understand it, to delve into the following: the essence of God and His bond with children. The Bible reveals that God is a just and merciful judge. Let's read Psalm 89, verse 14. "Justice and justice are the foundation of your throne. Mercy and truth go before your face." This verse provides a framework for understanding how God relates to children in the context of eternal judgment. Considering God's attributes of justice, judgment, mercy, and truth, we can interpret how these principles affect the question of the eternal destiny of children. First of all, God's justice and children. God's justice ensures that He treats everyone fairly and that His judgment is always right. However, divine justice is not measured like human justice, but from a perfect perspective, taking into account the nature, capacity of understanding, and context of each individual. In the case of children who do not have the full capacity to understand good and evil in the same way as adults, God's justice is manifested in a special way. God, in His justice, sees their innocence and vulnerability and does not judge them in the same way as an adult who is fully aware of sin. In many theological approaches, God's justice is believed to allow children, especially those who die before reaching spiritual maturity or the capacity to make moral decisions, to be received by Him with mercy rather than condemned. In second place, God's judgment on children. God's judgment is wise and perfect, and He knows the heart of every human being. In the case of children, His judgment is likely not to be the same as that of adults, since children have not yet come to a full knowledge of sin or salvation. God, in His judgment, understands each child's capacity to respond to the gospel and to divine grace. In third place, God's mercy. God's mercy is an essential attribute that reflects His compassion and love, especially toward the most vulnerable. God is merciful to children, showing them grace and protection. Divine mercy is not limited to forgiveness, but includes the preservation of life and constant care. This means that even if a child does not have the capacity to make fully formed moral decisions, God extends His mercy to save him. In the context of eternal judgment, many theologians believe that God's mercy covers little children, so that they would not face eternal damnation in hell, but would be welcomed into heaven. In fourth place, God's truth and children. God's attribute of truth is a fundamental pillar of His nature. God's truth is constant, faithful, revealing, and liberating. In everything He does, God is consistent with His own truth, and this truth is revealed to mankind to bring light, freedom, and salvation. Divine truth not only teaches us what is real, but also calls us to live according to that truth, guided by His Word and His Spirit. It is for this reason that, in judging children, God will do so according to His perfect truth. He judges with justice, but also with mercy, considering the innocence and ability of children. God always acts according to absolute truth, which means that His judgment will be fair, wise, and full of compassion toward the least of these. Jesus Himself said in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 19, verse 14, "Suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not, for of such is the kingdom of heaven." This verse is found in the context of a meeting where Jesus was teaching large crowds. At that moment, some children were brought to Him for blessing, but the disciples tried to push them away, probably thinking that Jesus should be focused on more important matters and not on the children. However, Jesus reacts firmly and tells the disciples to let the children come closer, explaining that the kingdom of heaven belongs to those who are like them. The first part of the statement, "Let the little children come to me," reflects the loving and accessible heart of Jesus. In the culture of that time, children were not considered a priority or people with important rights. However, Jesus gives them value, showing them that they too have a place in His kingdom. This invitation from Jesus is also an act of compassion and acceptance, as He was telling adults that they should not see children as a nuisance or an obstacle, but as those who have direct access to Him. Then Jesus says, "And do not stop them." Here, Jesus is correcting His disciples. The disciples, though well-intentioned, did not understand the importance of children to Jesus' message. "Do not hinder them" is a warning that we should not put up barriers to those who come to Christ, whether children or adults. Jesus emphasizes that everyone, regardless of age or status, is welcome to come to Him. The last part of the verse is key to understanding Jesus' message. By saying that of such is the kingdom of heaven, Jesus underlines the importance of the simple and humble faith that children represent. The last part of the verse is key to understanding Jesus' message. By saying that of such is the kingdom of heaven, Jesus underlines the importance of the simple and humble faith that children represent. Children in that time were seen as innocent, dependent, and humble. They had no ego, no confidence in their own righteousness or achievements. They simply relied on others, like their parents, to give them what they needed. Jesus is teaching that the kingdom of heaven is not for those who feel self-sufficient or who trust in their own righteousness, but for those who, like children, come with an attitude of humility and total dependence on God. The key here is that entrance into the kingdom of God is given to those who have a simple, open, trusting faith in Him, like that of a child toward its caregiver. Therefore, the message that Jesus declared regarding children offered them access to the kingdom of heaven. Now, to understand this topic more deeply, it is essential to go back to the root of everything. Since the story of Adam and Eve in Genesis, the Bible establishes that all human beings are born with a sinful nature as a result of the fall of humanity. This concept, known as original sin, implies that sin and its consequences have been passed on to all humanity since those early days in Eden. However, a crucial question arises. How does this concept apply to children who do not yet have the capacity to fully discern between right and wrong? While adults have the ability to discern between right and wrong, which involves making conscious decisions about their relationship with God, young children have not yet fully developed this ability. The crucial question this passage raises is, how does God apply the concept of original sin to children? That is, Although all human beings are born with the sinful nature inherited from Adam, are young children, not having the ability to choose between good and evil, held responsible for that original sin? Well, the answer is in line with the attributes of God that we have mentioned previously. Now the question arises, up to what age can children be considered innocent and not responsible for their spiritual decisions? While there is no clear and definitive consensus in the Bible on a specific age, based on traditional teachings and common interpretations within many Christian denominations, it is suggested that the age of responsibility, or age of spiritual maturity, could be between 7 and 12 years. Next, we present the reasons for this estimate. First of all, moral and cognitive development. In many contexts, it is believed that around age 7 children begin to understand concepts of morality, right and wrong, and have the ability to make conscious decisions about their actions. From that age on, some theologians suggest that children can begin to be responsible for their spiritual choices. In second place, the age of accountability in some Jewish and Christian cultures. In Jewish tradition, bar mitzvah for boys and bat mitzvah for girls occur around age 12, marking the transition into spiritual responsibility. This has influenced some Christian interpretations, which consider that, from adolescence onwards, children are aware of their decisions and have a greater capacity to understand the concept of sin. In third place, young children, 0 to 6 years old, would be considered innocent and if they die, would be welcomed into God's kingdom. Those over 7 years old are accountable to God. Although the Bible does not mention an exact age, it is important to recognize that this question is beyond our control, since it belongs to God. However, we know that when a child develops the faculties of discernment and understanding, he becomes in some way aware of his spiritual decisions. Now, as Christian parents, our primary responsibility is to guide our children in the path of the Lord. Since Old Testament times, God has clearly established that the teaching and spiritual formation of children is a fundamental mandate for parents. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 and 7, we read, "And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart, and you shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk of them when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise." This commandment emphasizes that the teaching of divine principles should not be limited to a specific moment, but should be an integral part of daily life, in every interaction and at every stage of our children's growth. As parents, we are our children's first and most important teachers in the faith. God entrusts us with the responsibility of teaching them not only moral and ethical values, but also to know Jesus Christ as their Savior and to live according to His teachings. Through our words, actions, and examples, we show them the way to a personal relationship with God. Furthermore, our responsibility does not end with just teaching them, but also with being a living reflection of what it means to follow Christ. Our children learn more from what they see in us than from what we tell them. Therefore, it is essential that we live according to the principles we teach, being a constant example of faith, love, forgiveness, and obedience to God. Dear listeners, as Christian parents, we must be diligent in teaching our children about God and His Word. This is not just a mandate, but a privilege and a blessing, as we are forming future generations in the faith and helping them establish a solid foundation for their entire spiritual life. Our greatest responsibility is to lead our children into a personal relationship with God, showing them His love and preparing them to live according to His will. And so we come to the end of this video. Thank you for being part of our channel. God bless you abundantly. Until the next video.